السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وبعد. As always, we commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for indeed He is the one who made us, He has created us, and we owe Him absolutely everything. We also send blessings and salutations upon the messenger whom He has sent to us, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we ask Allah to bless his entire household and all his companions, and we also ask Allah to bless every single one of us and to grant us goodness and to bless the two who are coming in nikah together today. The two families, may Allah unite them, inshallah, in His pleasure, and may Allah bring them together in a way that will be a contribution towards the upliftment of the Ummah. Ameen. And may Allah grant us all goodness in every single way. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we are gathered here about to witness a nikah. Do you know that it is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to witness the occasion of nikah, the officiation of the marriage? It is a sunnah, meaning it is an act of worship to come and take part. The entire Muslim ummah is always invited to witness this union. So no one can say, I was not invited, because to come into the masjid to witness this is a sunnah. We are all there, we are all invited. So what is the reason? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to seize the opportunity every time to say a few words. He never ever let it pass without saying some words. It used to be known as khutbatun nikah. Up to today, we have the khutbah. And we know, we read it in the Arabic language, we read a few verses of the Quran, you will hear the few verses of the Quran, the Imam will say one or two words over and above that from Hadith, and then he will continue to ask the questions. So we want to know, what is it and why is it that it is such a big act of worship to witness people getting married? One of the reasons, there are always many reasons, but we mention one of the reasons. One of the reasons is because all of us who are seated here, we are either married or we are not married. There is no third option. We are either married or we are not married. So if we are married, we have a lesson to learn. And if we are not married, we have a lesson to learn. If we are married, we need to ask ourselves, there was one day when I was just like this. So when I was just like this, how happy was I? MashaAllah. I was very happy, extremely delighted, also worried, you know, so worried. One day I was officiating nikah of a young man, like that he was loud mouth outside, but when he came here, he was very, you know, some people are a little bit more concerned. So I told him, have you accepted her in your nikah? So he told me, yeah. I told him, not yeah, say yes, I have. So he looked at me, he says, yes, you have. I said, not me, you. So he was so worried that he was trying to say the wrong thing. So that is excitement and happiness. We ask Allah to keep us as happy and even more happy after that. So what is the lesson? The lesson is, if you were here one day in the past, somewhere, you did a nikah, you were excited, you were so happy, ask yourself a question. When you witness officiation of someone else's nikah, how many do you witness? Maybe 10 in the year or 20 in the year? I think perhaps 10 or 20 in the year. 10 or 20 times ask yourself when you are sitting here, I was so happy that day. Today, am I as happy as that day? That's the question. The answer will either be yes or no. And the answer might be, I am even more happy. If that is the case, we say, Nurun ala Nur. Allah has blessed you. If you are happier than the day you were married, and there are some like that, may Allah increase the number, then Nurun ala Nur, which means light upon light, you have a gift and a double gift, mashallah. May Allah make our homes full of Nur. But if you are, even if you are as happy as the day you were getting married, also we will say, Alhamdulillah. Thank Allah, it is rare, it is a gem. But if you are not as happy, ask yourself, why? What happened? Where did I go wrong? Maybe after I got married, after some time, you know, they say new brooms sweep clean. Maybe after some time, the broom was not sweeping clean enough. We ask Allah to grant us understanding. We have 20 times in the year to reflect over the condition upon our marriage. I was married. What went wrong? Am I the mistake? Is the wife wrong? What happened? and try and identify the problem and resolve it. This is why we attend nikah, one of the reasons why we attend and we listen to lecture and we seize an opportunity. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to tell them a lot of the time, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. O you who believe, be conscious of your Maker and make sure that whatever you utter is only upright. These verses were repeated even at times during the nikah khutbah. Why? Because do you know your tongue is so important to make your marriage work or to break your marriage? Your tongue is so important. How do you talk in your house? What do you say? What do you utter? Your children, your wife, your parents, your in-laws, the others. How is your relation with them? You have 20 times minimum in the year to ponder over that. How then can we go wrong? If we look at nikah and officiation of nikah in the correct sense, can we go wrong? The answer is no. The problem with us, we come, we get happy, we see, what did they distribute? The sweets were nice. How was the food? Very nice. How was the hall? Very nice. Oh, it was very good nikah. So to us, we have become material to the degree that the goodness of the nikah is based on what they gave and the food they had. No longer on the lesson we learned. Whereas that is not important. The more important thing is the lesson. Look at my condition. How did me attending this nikah help my wife and I to lead a happier home? That is the question. Don't lose focus on that. It's very important that we realize this. And this is why we say those who are married, this is an opportunity to resolve your problems. And this is an opportunity to look at your life and to come back again together. You know what the Christians do? We don't learn from them, but if we think of what they do, Islam has better than that. After some years when they are tired now, you know, and they are fed up, and then they have something known as the rejuvenation of that marriage. The union is done again, so they will go to another country and pretend like they are getting married afresh. In order to rekindle once again, they go on a new honeymoon, subhanallah. A'udhu billah. What a joke, what a fake. We have the deen that tells us that throughout the year, as you are attending different people's nikah, you must concentrate on yours and ask yourself, how am I faring in my own test? What is the point of attending 50 nikah when the one we have done is in shambles? May Allah grant us lesson. So let us all make an intention here and now that we will solve our problems today. You give and take. No problem. Go out there and do what you have to in order to solve your matter. And then you will lead a successful life. Believe me, if your marriage is in harmony, your future life is in harmony. If your marriage is in disorder, your future life, Allah knows, but there is a greater chance of it being in disorder. It's not easy to live in life when at home there is politics. And at home there is already something happening there which is like an inferno and a fire. Then we have another category of people amongst us who are not yet married. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam during nikah, he used to say, يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابَ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاءَةَ فَلْيَتَزَوَّجْ فَإِنَّهُ أَحْصَنُ لِلْفَرْجِ وَأَغَضُّ لِلْبَصَرِ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَعَلَيْهِ بِالصَّوْمِ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say, O youth, O young people, whoever is able and capable to get married, then do so. Whoever is able and capable to get married, do not waste time, do not delay, do so. And whoever is not able, then you should fast, because fasting will help you. And whoever is able, you should do so, because it will be better for the protection of your gaze and for the protection of your private parts. What this means is, if you delay your daughter to get married, or you delay your son to get married unnecessarily, then you are responsible for their gaze not being in order, and for them proning their private parts to sin. May Allah protect us. So don't delay. If you are able and capable, do not waste time. Many people say, no, you know, the brother is already 23, 24, 25. They say, no, I am doing PhD. I need to wait. Wait for what? When I start to get big money, I will marry. Do you know our fathers, and including some of our generation as well, when they married, they couldn't afford shoes. They did not have shoes. And slowly but surely their life was built together. And they earned the money and became wealthy later on. Today, we don't understand how a person waits to become rich before he marries. And this is why the girls also, there is a growing trend. They look for a rich man who is already settled in life. And they want someone who has a car and a house and everything set already. They don't understand that sometimes the good people, maybe they don't yet have all that, get married and slowly you will work towards that. We need to know this. Islam did not say that you must be very rich before you marry. No, you must be able to afford your food, clothing and accommodation that is basic, and you get married, you work hard and you try to build, and inshallah things will happen. So let us realize that sometimes we block our daughters from getting married, and it is a sickness that comes among sometimes the educated class, where they say, no, finish your degree first. But you are not worried about zina that is committed. And the Prophet ﷺ says, we made nikah so easy so that you do not have an excuse to commit adultery. And yet we are saying, no, you must wait. Daughter is very shy. She won't talk to you. She won't tell you. She said, okay, dad. But she can't tell you, dad, what you are saying is the wrong thing. I want to get married. She can't say that. So please open your eyes. Allah will ask you. And Allah will really question you regarding how you have handled your daughters. With respect, they might say, no, it's okay. Don't worry, I will be patient. But during the time of patience, something might happen behind your back just because you are pushing and pushing and pushing. Don't worry. Believe me. Yes. It might be important to get your education, but it is more important to have a happy home. And it is more important to get married properly and to do your nikah and to protect yourself from adultery and your children. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nara. O you who believe, save yourselves and your family members from the fire of Jahannam. Save yourselves and your family members. So which means don't allow them to get into a position where they would be prone to committing sin because of your deed, your action, because of something you are blocking and so on. So let us open the doors for our children. Another very important point. إِذَا أَتَاكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ. When someone has proposed for your daughter and they have deen which is acceptable and akhlaq which are acceptable, then do not refuse them unnecessarily. Some people, they want to force their daughters. Up to today it is happening. And it is happening even in some developed countries. People force their daughters, look, you will marry your cousin whether you like it or not. Finish. It is my command. Wallahi, Allah did not say that. Yes, you can guide her, you can tell her, look, I am not agreeing with this gentleman. But you cannot impose your gentleman on her. You can say, let's see someone else. What about this man? She will say, no. You say, what about this one? She will say, okay. Then you are happy. Both of you are happy. So you need to make both parties happy. We are asking the daughters to make their parents happy, and we are asking the parents to make their daughters happy. We are being balanced. We are not being unfair. It is balanced. Our daughters are not our property. They are an amana. They are the property of Allah. They will be taken away from us even before death through marriage. Because what is marriage? النكاح رق فلينظر أحدكم أين يضع كريمته. Nikah is similar to giving your child away in such a manner that the man whom you are giving your daughter to will have greater authority over your child from that day on than you yourself. So be careful where you are giving your daughter. That means when you give your daughter away, your authority becomes less and the husband's authority is more. Finished. There you are. That is the statement, النكاح رق فلينظر أحدكم أين يضع كريمته. So this is why be careful where you are giving your daughter, because once you give it, they become big boss. In the sense that, you know, you have a treasure and you have a password. And then once you give the password to someone else, they will change it, then they have the treasure. Allahu Akbar. They have the treasure. Now if you want something, you need to ask them, please, what is the password? Or can you open treasure for me? I need X, Y and Z. What happens to our daughters? They are a treasure. We hand over the password to someone. We expect them to look after our child. We must not impose things that they are unhappy about. We must not impose that. Because your daughter will make dua for you if you have chosen a good husband for her. Or if you have helped her to marry a good man. But some people, there is ignorance in them. I know personally of cases where One man owed another man a big amount of money. So he said, look, I can't afford, but I can give you my daughter. That man said, yes, bring, come, bring her. A'udhu billah. What is this? You are dealing with them like the kuffar of Quraysh. The people before Islam, the Jahiliyyah period of ignorance, where they were buying and selling daughters because of commodity. We are Muslim, we don't do that. For us, we will also ask her, what is your opinion, my daughter? I have this suggestion, what do you think? She says, no dad, I am not happy. Okay, we have another suggestion, what is your view? We have a third suggestion, what is your view? We have a fourth suggestion, what is your view? Somewhere, somehow, after four, five maximum, maybe more than that, less than that, she will say, no problem, this one I am happy. Alhamdulillah. You are happy, she is happy. And the same applies to the daughters. We should try our best not to displease our parents when it comes to marriage. Consider them. And think very carefully, this is my father, this is my mother, he looked after me, she looked after me for so many years. If I am going to say, I want to marry that man, he's not Muslim, please, can you help me? You might make them suffer heart attack. May Allah protect us. So talk to them nicely, see, come to a compromise, reach some good solution, inshallah, and we open the doors. Marriage is something that is there to bring people together, not to drift people apart. And yes, when someone has accepted Islam, they are our brothers and sisters indeed. We do not distinguish, we do not differentiate. They are our brothers and sisters in Islam. Now let's continue to one more category of people that we find. We spoke to those who are married. We spoke to those who have not yet married. Now we are speaking to those who have lost their spouses, either through divorce or through death. If you have lost your spouse through divorce or death, remember it is not the end of the road. You are encouraged to get married again, no matter how old you are, no matter what it is. I have a friend of mine back in South Africa, very old, I think now he is 79. He told me, please look for a good wife for me. So the young man sitting with us said, what does he want wife for? So he heard. He said, I just want someone to sit and talk to and, you know, to share the rest of my life with. So I told that young man, hey, keep quiet. Later on I called him, I said, you know, you don't understand. You are young. You think marriage is only, you know, for young people. No. Even old people, they need company. They just need someone to talk to. They need to be happy. You know, you can sit and have a cup of tea. Instead of one, there are two, you are feeling so happy. MashaAllah. You know, you sit outside, you relax. Someone has an ear to hear your joke. MashaAllah. And you have an ear to hear someone else breathing. It's enough for you to be happy. That is Allah. Allah has created us that way. So let us remember, if there has been death, we can always get up and continue. We marry again by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also if there has been a divorce, it's not the end of the road. I know divorce is on the increase. There are problems. Sometimes man is to blame, woman is to blame, sometimes both are to blame. Many times it is because we don't understand Islam. And we don't realize the law of Islam. Wallahi, if you surrender to the law of Allah, your marriage will be happy. If both parties are surrendering to the law of Allah, what does Allah say? You know, I know. We know what Allah says regarding your tongue, regarding how you act, regarding what is permissible, what is not permissible, regarding the limit of marriage and everything. We know what Allah says. When we surrender to what Allah says, our marriage cannot go wrong. Because there is taqwa, there is consciousness of Allah. But when there is no consciousness of Allah, everything can go wrong. Everything goes wrong. And I will leave it for you to think of what I have said. Because Allah says in these verses that are read normally in the khutbah, you will hear the word ittaqullah, 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 four times. Four times you will hear it. So that means be conscious of your maker. Be conscious. You should know He is there. You should know you are answerable to him and so on. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors, to grant us goodness. As I said, we have also seized this opportunity to remind the brothers and sisters of a few of these reminders. So we hope Allah can help us in our marriages, all of us, and Allah can open the doors for the young boys and girls also to find suitable partners who will be coolness of their eyes, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can also help those who are suffering some turbulence in their marriage to resolve their matters. As I said, if you want Allah's law to apply, your marriage problem will solve within 5 seconds. Not even 5 seconds. If you want Allah's law to apply, your marriage problem is resolved immediately. The problem comes when we become selfish, when we want to pull our side, when we don't want to follow Allah's command, then there are problems. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors. I end by asking Allah to really bring the couple together today in happiness. And if you notice, I did not put on my cloak, because normally when you have nikah of someone else, it is their day, not yours. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.